Hi, I'm Oscar. In June 2016, I travelled to Angola to meet up with my friend Alfie. Together, we completed the first ever source-to-mouth navigation of the Kwanza River, a journey of over 1,300 kilometres. Over our 32-day journey, we kayaked, we hiked, and we waded. We met a whole host of interesting people, from security forces to diamond miners, farmers, and fishermen. Things didn't always go smoothly. We were chased by hippos, bitten by insects, and picked up some nasty injuries. We also crashed and sank the kayak in some rapids, losing a load of our gear. Oh, and just to top it all off, the Angolan security forces arrested and detained us for 4 days, threatening us with deportation. Despite all these problems, on July 6th, we paddled out into the Atlantic Ocean and completed our journey. This is the story of how we did it. Angola is a large country in southern Africa with a long Atlantic coastline. The capital, Luanda, was my home for 5 years up until 2014. I was in Angola teaching history at the international school, as well as writing a travel guide to the country, and getting as much surfing in as possible. I met Alfie through a rugby club in Luanda in 2013.
Hello, I'm Alfie, and for the last 2.5 years I've been living in Luanda, the capital of Angola. And during this time, I've had the pleasure of being able to explore the amazing Kwanza River in my spare time. And this has inspired our trip from the source to the mouth in June this year.
In October 2014, Alfie and his brothers bought a pair of 1960s German collapsible kayaks, called Kleppers, and completed a 300-kilometre journey along the lower sections of the Kwanza River. It was this journey that provided the inspiration for tackling the whole thing. The journey seemed extra appealing as the Kwanza is Angola's longest river. If we were successful, we would set a new Guinness World Record, but we had a lot of planning to do before thinking about that. Angola was a Portuguese colony for 5 centuries. The Angolan people won their freedom in 1975 after a 13-year battle for independence. Once the Portuguese had left, Angola descended into a bloody civil war which lasted until 2002. The legacy of all this fighting is that Angola today is one of the most landmine-affected countries in the world. These mines have taken thousands of lives and injured an estimated 80,000 Angolans. It took us 9 months to plan this journey, and one of the first things that we decided was that we'd like to try and raise money for a charity that was working to remove these landmines. The Halo Trust is the oldest and largest humanitarian landmine clearance organisation in the world, working in 16 countries and territories, including Angola. We set our fundraising target as £7,055, which is about $10,000. This was enough to pay for 1 month of work by a Halo demining team. This would result in the clearance of around 4,000 square metres of minefields in a place called Quito Carnavale, in the southeast of Angola. Quito Carnavale was the scene of a huge battle during the Angolan Civil War in 1987, and now has the unfortunate title of Africa's most mined town. The Halo Trust was extremely supportive of our plan and offered to help us with logistics for the expedition. When we started planning the trip in August 2015, Alfie was still living in Luanda, whereas I was based in London. Alfie had to spend hours poring over satellite photography to plot out a route and work out which sections of the river were navigable and what the casualty evacuation procedures were going to be. Alfie was also in charge of running around various ministries and getting us the necessary paperwork for the trip. We had no idea what paperwork was required, and we're pretty sure the ministries didn't either, but we thought it might be useful to have official-looking documents. Bits of paper with stamps on them are always good to wave around at the various police checkpoints we were inevitably going to be stopped at. While Alfie was busy doing this, I was in London, sourcing and purchasing all the equipment we were going to require. I also spent a good month annoying my girlfriend by stinking out our flat with a food dehydrator so that we could vacuum seal all our expedition rations. Tuna, pumpkin, bolognese, you name it, I dehydrated it and stuck it in a small bag for the trip. We were both also doing as much kayaking and hiking as possible to get in shape. Alfie got to do it on the Kwanza, whereas I was stuck with the freezing River Thames and Lee Valley Whitewater Centre. 9 months seemed to fly by, and soon it was time for me to jump on a plane with all our kit and meet Alfie in Luanda. On the 4th of June, we took a flight with Angolan national carrier TAG Airlines from Luanda to Huambo. We were picked up by Harriet, who works for the Halo Trust, and driven to their HQ in town.
So the Halo Trust has kindly let us stay in their property in Huambo, which is called Casablanca, the White House. So it's a massive place. It used to be, back during the war, the Civil War, it used to be home to the ICRC. And apparently there were up to 30 people living here at a time. So as you can see, they've got an amazing bar area, big pizza oven there at the back, and quite a lot of space. I mean, it's a big house. At the moment, there are only two people living here, and one of them's away. So it feels very, very empty. So there's been plenty of space for us to crash here for one night, but this morning we're gonna head off and we're gonna be driving to the source of the Kwanza. Takes about 4 hours to get there from here. It's all on good roads, apparently. Oop. One of the Halo cats. Oh goodness, another Halo cat. And lots of Halo kittens. Lovely. So anyway, it's about 8 a.m. We're leaving in an hour and we're hoping to get to the source by about 1 o'clock and then get going. So this is our drone testing at the Halo house. Whoa. Go on, go up in the air a bit. Not into the tree though. Okay.
Huambo, formerly called Nova Lisboa under Portuguese rule, was heavily affected by the Civil War. Even today, you can see the scars of fighting all over the city. Halo have a huge base in Huambo, where they store a lot of the equipment used for mine clearance. As you can see, it's an expensive business. Harriet also gave us a tour of their visitor displays, and we saw some of the ordnance that they've made safe. Huambo was also our final opportunity to have a big meal before starting a month of strict rations.
We're having our very last hungry lion for the trip.
I really hope we don't regret this tomorrow when we're out in the middle of nowhere.
After a night in the Halo house, we drove eastwards for 4 hours to the source of the Kwanza River. The further into the drive we got, the more remote and isolated it seemed. There was a growing fear in the back of my mind at how far from help we were if something went wrong. Alfie's ambitious itinerary had us finishing the expedition in 30 days, with us doing an average of 50 kilometres of kayaking per day, or 20 kilometres of hiking. We had the river divided into three sections. The first section ran from the source up to what we called the Quito Bridge, which was near the town of Kamakupa. It was very isolated, but as far as we could tell, there weren't too many obstacles. The second section, running from Kamakupa to a bridge near Melange, was full of rapids and waterfalls and would involve a lot of portage, which is a fancy French way of saying carrying the bloody kayak. The third section, starting at Dondo, initially involved a large hike past two hydroelectric dams, the first one being Capanda, then a clear 220 kilometres of kayaking to the finish. This was going to be by far the easiest section, as there were no hippos, no rapids, no waterfalls, or anything like that on the lower stretches of the Kwanza. So here we are, dropped at the source with our 105 kilograms of equipment, ready to go.
We're at the end of day one, and we're about a kilometre away from the source. We said goodbye to the Halo team earlier at the source and took all of our last photos and videos at the source and headed off. We've learnt two things today. The first is that it's very hard work walking along narrow paths because it means we have to lug all of our klepper and parts there and back and double up on ourselves in order to transport the 100 kilos or so that we've got. We've also learnt that it's pretty cold up here. We're at about 1,500 metres. But the good news is we're in a good location near the main track, which heads north. So we're going to be up early tomorrow morning, have a bit of porridge, and we hope to make a decent amount of kilometres over the course of the day.
Morning. It's about 6:30 on day two. Just thought I'd do a quick update before we actually start moving. So that there's the camp. There's the remains of the fire. This is where we slept. It's about a kilometre away from the source, which is that way. So last night it was absolutely freezing. In fact, it was probably about 5 degrees, which is a bit of a surprise. I think we knew it was going to be that cold, but I didn't realize how cold 5 degrees is until I tried to go to sleep. So yeah, I'm glad I've got a three-season sleeping bag. Had issues with my tent. Realized that I should have probably tried putting it up in the UK before I came to Angola. So I ended up sleeping in the fetal position because it's way too small. So we're going to have to work something out at lunchtime today. Alfie's just wandered off. We're going to have to move in sections. So we're going to have to do 4 trips because we've got so much gear. We've got 100 kilos of gear back there. And once we get up to the road, which is about a kilometre away, we can construct the trike. And then from then on, it's going to be dragging it. So it shouldn't be too bad. And we reckon we've got less than 40 kilometres till we get to a point on the river where we can actually start kayaking, which is good. So hopefully by tomorrow evening, we will have reached a point. We can camp right by the river and then we can get started the day after.
The start of the expedition was very tough. We had to walk about 55 kilometres along sandy tracks to reach a place called Soma Kwanza. At this point, the Kwanza River is finally wide enough to be navigable. The cart we had adapted from a kite buggy also needed a few modifications to cope with the harsh terrain and all of our gear. But in the end, we made it to Soma Kwanza, our entry point for the Kwanza River.
Just as the sun was going down this evening, we reached Soma Kwanza, which is the largest village along this stretch of the Kwanza River. And a short distance away from our entry point tomorrow. So we're looking forward to getting kayaking. And we've been very fortunate to be welcomed with open arms all, and some rather curious looks to Soma Kwanza. And after a bit of explaining as to what we're doing, we've been housed in the forecourt of the local police station where we've put up our tent and are now getting to sleep. And there's a little bit of chitter chatter from the local policeman off to the side, as you may be able to hear. Anyway, that's all for tonight.
After a great night's sleep in the police station at Soma Kwanza, we were given a police escort about 2 kilometres out of town to show us where to get into the river. The police, like everyone we met along the way, were fascinated to watch Alfie turn a few bags of loose parts into a 5.5-metre-long two-man kayak.
We've reached a monumental point in our journey. Upstream to us here is the overgrown Kwanza with waterfalls along the way, and we have just arrived after a lot of trekking at this beautifully clear watered spot. All our gear ready to go there after a lot of help from the local policeman. And downstream is what looks to be clear river.
Turns out, when the locals said it's definitely navigable from this point onwards, what they actually meant was, it's clear for a bit, then a reed-filled meandering disaster for the next 30 kilometres. Our first 2 days of kayaking were not a fun experience, especially thanks to the local insects. The reeds got so dense in some sections that Alfie had to hack a path through with a machete, while I dragged us forwards by grabbing the reeds. The whole time we were praying that there weren't any hippos around. After about 11 kilometres, the river finally opened up a little and we were able to kayak normally. Our main obstacle at this stage was man-made. Local fishermen would construct wooden dams across the river to hold fish traps. We treated them like a minor inconvenience at the time, but later in the journey, one dam in particular would cause us major problems. The first few days of kayaking were very isolated and absolutely freezing. It went below zero at night. Occasionally, we would bump into fishermen, who were a really useful source of information about hippo locations, but generally speaking, we were alone. Well, apart from the hippos. There were a lot more hippos than expected, which was a bit of a concern.
Basically, we are about 30 kilometres outside of Quito Bridge, so we did about 55k today, which was good. It was smooth sailing, no hippos, which is a great relief, because the day before there were so many hippos. So many hippos. We had them flying at us. It's like a shooting gallery, had them going underneath the boat, had them very close to the boat, very, very worried that we're going to get tipped out of the boat or, you know, accidentally go too close to one and make it angry. But did all right in the end. So yeah, 30k tomorrow, couple of rapids maybe. We're not sure whether we can go through them or we're going to have to pull the kayak. I'm hoping we can go through them. And then some R&R by Quito Bridge at the Halo Trust compound.
It also didn't take long for us to start seeing evidence of another human use of the river, diamond mining. This continued for the majority of our journey.
And just in the distance, although I'm not quite sure you can see it, just past Alfie, there's a series of tents. So there's a camp down by the river. We assume that is a diamond camp, but we're not going to go down and check it out because I don't think they'd appreciate tourists filming them. This is a road that they've built all the way along the side of the Kwanza River, and as you can see, not great for the environment, I don't think. I think they've just ploughed a bulldozer right down here and then burned it a certain section. So yeah, big kind of scar on the landscape. As you can see, massive mining camp, and you've got guys on the water dredging for diamonds as well. So pretty common sight down here. Usually we don't want to go near them because they drag a huge line across the river to use as a pontoon.
We made great progress in our first week of kayaking, and it seemed like nothing could stop us.
So here we are on Wednesday. It's about 10 in the morning, and later on this afternoon we're going to arrive by the Quito Bridge. Some much needed R&R, and that should represent a third of the journey done. We've got the small matter of some rapids to negotiate before we get there. I think they're about 6 kilometres away at the moment. So we're hoping we can make our way through those smoothly and not have to get out and carry the boat because the boat's heavy. And if you have a look around, this is pretty typical scenery for us at the moment.
Unfortunately for us, on Wednesday the 15th of June, exactly 10 days into the trip, our luck ran out.
So it's about 6:30 a.m. and here is a typical morning as we get up. Bright sunshine, which is nice, but also quite heavy fog, which means everything's very, very wet. So most days we're putting our tents away wet, which is frustrating. And also it means we have to wait to get on the river. That's the river there. Obviously you can't see anything. Not a good idea to go out with no visibility when there might be hippos around. So usually it clears at about 7:30 or just after. So we're waiting for that point.
We tried to navigate through a narrow gap in a fishing dam built across some rapids.
So what we tried to do is we tried to kind of go between two sets of barriers, which on reflection, it was a bad move. Probably should have got out, dismantled the kayak and carried it round, or dragged the kayak. It was only a few hundred meters. But anyway, tried to go through, obviously didn't make it. We ended up coming sideways up to the barrier, and then we slammed into the barrier with obviously a load of water pushing us very, very hard against the barrier, so we couldn't get away from it. We were all right for a while, but very, very quickly we started taking on water and basically the kayak started sinking. So what we did is we both got out. I guess we accepted it was going to fill with water. We got out quickly and we started unloading the bags. So we pulled the bags off and climbed them along the barrier onto an island that it was attached to. Very, very luckily, and mainly thanks to Alfie's quick thinking, we got all of the essential gear, which is why I'm able to do diary cam today, actually. So we got every single bag off. I mean, some of it was very wet, but we managed to recover it. And we only had a few things that weren't secured in the kayak lost. So I think we lost my boots. That's a bit of a big issue. We lost Alfie's khaki trousers, which are the only trousers he's got. We lost Alfie's fleece. We lost our last water-to-go water filtration bottle, so that's a bit of a hassle. A load of sun cream and a couple of spare parts. And in the end, I think we lost one tire for the buggy, but that's a spare. So all in all, I think we got very lucky. We also, because of all the water coming on board, we broke a number of electronic items. So I broke my Kindle, I broke my Samsung phone, I think one of the GoPros went. We broke one or two of the Lenovos that we were given by the Wild Bird Trust to try and record birds. So sorry guys, but we have been recording the birds, just on paper, not on those things. To get the actual kayak out, so three local fishermen actually came and helped us, and we had to essentially lift up the barrier and then wedge the kayak out, which was extremely difficult. I mean, The kayak weighs about 50 kilos on its own, and then it was full of water as well, with water running against it. But we managed to get out in the end, and we managed to refloat it. And then I guess this is when our second mistake happened. So instead of then lifting it over the barrier and taking it downstream and then getting it out, what we tried to do is kind of shimmy it along the barrier to the bank. It was only about 10 or 15 meters, so we thought it'd be all right. But basically, exactly the same thing happened again. So all five of us were holding on to it, and it just started taking on water, went sideways, slammed into the barrier, and this time it was a lot more serious because it was in a much more difficult position. It was actually at risk of being pierced by the barrier. So by the time we got it out a second time and onto shore, it had actually been quite seriously damaged. So we snapped a number of the sort of rib sections that go down the middle, a lot of the struts. I mean, of all the wooden parts in the clepper, I'd say that about a third of them were seriously damaged, and like snapped, basically. Luckily, the plastic hull itself wasn't actually ripped in any way. So, I mean, Alfie knows more about it than me, but he thinks it's fixable. And we knew that there was a diamond concession and a road about 2 kilometers down the track from where we were. Luckily, the guys at the concession had already seen what had happened to us earlier on and had actually come back to check that we were okay. And one of the managers came back and showed us where to go, took us back to the dirt track, and then actually gave us a lift all the way to Kamakupa, which is actually a long way. I think it was about 60 kilometers in a 4x4 he took us. And then he took us to Kamakupa, which is where we are now. So they let us crash very kindly in their house. So we actually got a bed for the night. We got some food, which was great. And then today we are trying to sort out all the problems with the clepper. So I'll show you what's going on with the clepper at the moment. So looking out the window of our place, oh, they're back. So we've found a carpenter. So all the stuff's laid out, all the broken stuff. The guy in orange is the carpenter. He said he reckons he can fix it with the right stuff. So what we're going to do is we're going to hopefully tell him what to do, leave that with him to fix, and then when it's all done, we can redo the 16-kilometer section that we didn't do, and then we can just continue with our journey.
We spent a day in Kamakupa with the Halo Trust guys, Amadeus here and Firmino, finding a carpenter to fix the broken kayak. About a third of the wooden components in the clepper were damaged, so it was a big job. I also had to go shopping and find some shoes to replace my lost boots. The only ones I could find were the Nike Air Jordans that Alfie is sporting in this shot. Sadly, they were a size too small, as nobody in Angola seems to have size 11 feet. Problems finding shoes would cause me issues for the rest of the trip. While we were waiting for the carpenter to fix the kayak, we walked back to the point where we'd sunk and hiked from there all the way to the Quito Bridge. This was the spot we'd intended to meet the Halo guys at and ensured that we did not leave any gaps in our journey from the source to the mouth. Bizarrely, the Halo Trust had organised for us to camp in an Angolan military base.
What are we doing, Alfie?
Mapping out the route with a bit of a revised schedule.
Yes, in the hope that we're going to have some Halo Trust logistics support.
Exactly.
Yes. You see, things are pretty busy here on the... what are these guys called? The Casa Militar Army Base. Some physical training happening over there. They actually went out last night and left us as the only people on the military base, which, given that we're foreigners, strikes me as a bit strange. But the place is pretty much empty because they're all forward deployed on the actual minefields that they're clearing. So we stayed in that tent last night, which was actually quite warm. And I think there's only about 3 or 4 guys around.
So, after spending the night in one of their large tents, we had a rethink of our strategy. Our gear was too heavy and we needed to be carrying less, especially as the next third of the river was full of obstacles. We went through all our gear and dumped anything non-essential. Sadly, this included our drone, which had miraculously survived total submersion in the sinking. After lightening our kit, we picked up the newly repaired kayak and headed back out onto the Kwanza, with a 2-day delay to make up somehow.
Hello, do an update then. So we've made our way down to the Kwanza. There we go. We think we got the boat sorted out, so we started a trek from where we were waiting. We were supposed to do about 15k, got no idea how far we went, got a bit lost. But anyway, some of the local guys showed us where to go, and this is now an entry point for the Kwanza. So This is called Ilia. It's got a massive waterfall over the other side, but just past that point is where we're getting in. No more white water, at least we hope, because we can't keep sinking the kayak every time we get in. Ah! Right, so, been very well looked after here, as you can see. One of the local kids, Isaac, he just gave me a massive sugar cane to keep me entertained. And then within about 5 seconds, managed to create this, which is probably the most impressive fire that we've had for the whole trip. So a little bit embarrassing given that he's about 10 years old and didn't have any fire lighters. So Alfie and that lot have run up that hill to go and see where the 4x4 is and make sure everything's on track. And then the plan is to camp somewhere around here, don't know, and then get going tomorrow morning. And we've got a lot of time to make up for, so hoping for a good day of kayaking tomorrow.
Watching the sunrise on the icy cold beach, we were relieved to be continuing our journey, but concerned that the repairs might not hold up for another 1,000 kilometres.
It's Saturday the 18th of June. Today we managed about 50 kilometres along the river with two portages around rapids. It was a great relief to get going again after 2 days of sitting around in summer Kwanza, and a little bit further upriver we did a short 15k walk to a spot further upriver where the Halo Trust guys and an engineer from summer Kwanza delivered us our new klepper parts, which were all botched together with some iron sheets and some thick rivets. We were a bit dubious about whether they're going to hold, but we're very pleased to have done 50k and got going. And we've got another couple of days until we see the Halo Trust guys again in Dando. It's going to be more kayaking and walking around rapids. We think we've got at least 20k to walk before we get to Dando. So we're stripped down to the bare minimums of what we need in the klepper, so we can quickly pack up our stuff and portage around.
On the 19th of June, we were faced with a long walking section towards Dando as the water was not navigable. We stopped at a village, packed up the klepper, put it on our backs and got going. Because this section was through thick forest, we did not use the buggy, as we're not sure it would fit, so everything had to be carried. We were now facing a 2-week stretch of constant obstacles. This section of the river was filled with rapids and waterfalls. Alfie had 17 marked from his satellite photography. A few of the villagers were pleased to earn some extra money by helping us carry some of our gear, although Alfie and I had to carry the klepper kayak ourselves due to the requirements of Guinness World Records. Basically, we had to move the kayak from the source to the mouth under our own steam with no help in order to set a new world record.
Welcome to our campsite. We're just about to set off for the last push to Dando. So we've got 15 kilometres of kayaking, should be rapid free, and then we've got to get out, 15 kilometre walk, and that's it, we're there. Get to meet the Halo Trust guys, resupply, and then plan for the 40k hike that's going to come tomorrow. Check out where we camped tonight. Absolutely beautiful place. So today's the day I've been least excited about, which is we're in Dando and we now need to walk 40 kilometers to get past all the rapids so that we can get back in the water. I'm having some serious issues with my feet, as you can probably see. Definitely not be walked on for 40 kilometres, so I guess I'm going to have to take it slow and see how things go today, but very, very worried about whether I'm going to be able to walk or not and how it's going to feel.
On the 21st of June, we managed to trek 32 kilometres to a village where the sober told us we could camp. They stuck us in a storage hut, which was much better than sleeping in tents. However, all the local kids came and watched us all evening, so there wasn't much privacy. Would you believe that these guys all have the same father? That morning, we got up, completed a short trek to the river, and then got going again. I was very pleased to be off my feet. Sadly, we had bigger things to worry about. That evening, we were almost attacked by two aggressive male hippos. We couldn't find a way of navigating past them, so we had to spend the night in a village, and the sober assured us that in the morning, two fishermen would show us a safe path past the hippos.
Hi, Alfie.
Morning.
What are we doing?
We are receiving an escort past three slightly grumpy hippos.
Yeah, they wouldn't let us go past yesterday, but apparently this morning they're going to be more amenable to our demands, but we'll have to see. What's going on, Alfie?
We've had to bail into the side.
Yeah, the locals made a beeline for the tree and said get in the tree. The reason being, grumpy Mr. Hippo, can you hear him? He's kind of chased us into the corner. I don't know if you can see. You can. That's not very good at all. There's the twin causes of our problems, just watching us, refusing to move.
These hippos got within 10 metres of us, which was way too close for comfort. Luckily, they lost interest and swam off after half an hour. Hippos behind us, we pushed on. This section of the Kwanza was absolutely filled with diamond mines.
So we're at a diamond mine at the moment, or we haven't seen anyone yet. You can see over there one of their lines across the water, which they use for dredging. And then if you see it right down there, some boats and stuff. But we have yet to see any people. This is a huge Angolan diamond concession. If you look over there, these guys have got some serious kit. Just been told by the Portuguese manager in English what we should be doing. If you look, there they are, completely trashing the side of the river. And we've been seeing this all day, in fact, the past few days. This is the largest one we've seen, but if you have a look at the environmental impact of the diamond mining, it's pretty intense.
We loved having the miners around us as it felt less isolated. It also meant we could buy food from them sometimes. They even had kuka. For the next 4 days, we pushed on with the usual routine. On the 27th of June, we finally completed the second section of our trip by arriving at Melange Bridge. We were very excited to reach Melange Bridge as it marked the end of our second section of the journey, and also the end of most of the uncertainty. As far as we were aware, there were no more hippos further ahead. Also, Alfie had been able to drive out and explore this section, so we had a much better idea of what to expect. There was one waterfall between us and Kapanda Dam, then flat water. We couldn't wait.
So here's our bedroom from last night. The police station, I suppose, or the police control post right by the bridge. Very kindly gave us these mattresses so we didn't have to put our tents up. We got absolutely munched by mosquitoes and didn't really get much sleep, but still, we're going to push on today.
Due to a mix-up with Halo, we were expecting a food resupply here, but the driver couldn't make it. This meant that we had to restock using whatever we could find in the very sparse local shop. The only things they seemed to sell were chorizo, sweets and biscuits. It's a miracle we didn't get scurvy. The section of water from Melange Bridge to Kapanda Dam was tough. There were lots of rapids, and we badly damaged the underside of the boat, which meant we started taking on water.
Look where we found at the end of the day. Actually, we almost kayaked off the end of it, but look at that. Now we've only got about 60 kilometers to go till Kapanda Dam, then it's 120k walking, then the final 200k, and then we made it. So assuming we don't smash up the kayak in the next day, it's survived, basically, because Alfie knows exactly what the final section is like. What an amazing place to spend the evening.
We also had to get past this. Which involved a bit of this. Also, the 50 kilometers of water in front of the dam is completely static. as it's a floodplain. With no current to help us out, our average speed dropped from about 7 kilometers per hour to 5 kilometers per hour, making progress much slower and tougher. We also ran out of food.
So, welcome to the kayak. It's lunchtime. So we checked in yesterday and showed you the delicious lunch that we had, the fuel for athletes. We've changed up the diet slightly today due to a lack of food, basically. What are we having for lunch, Alfie?
We have a single lollipop each.
That is my lunch. That.
Desperate time.
We've already been kayaking for what, like 5 hours or something?
Yeah, we are 30-something K in.
30-something K in, and our lunch is a raspberry and cream lollipop. Things have really taken a turn for the worst here on the kayak trip. But we have got food for dinner, we just need to cook it.
Thankfully we can nearly see the end of the kayak.
Oh yeah?
Oh, we can see the dam.
Is that the dam?
Yeah.
All right, there you go. I'm not sure if you can see it, but apparently that's the dam. Good stuff. Right, I'm gonna tuck into my piri cream lunch. Lovely.
How confident we were. We thought all we had to do was go around the dam, and then it was a walking section, and then we were basically homeward bound on the last section that Alfie had already done. In the immortal words of Dr. Pepper, what's the worst that could happen?
So we've had quite an interesting turn of events here. We are coming to you live from the provincial police station. So we managed to set up camp at the local fishing village after getting to the dam. And then we went to sleep, and then at about 12:30 we were woken up at gunpoint by a group of about 6 or 7 security officials, promptly handcuffed and dragged out of our tents, and then all of our tents were kind of rolled up and we were chucked in a 4x4 and driven all the way over here back to the dam. So it wasn't a very pleasant way of waking up. The guy in charge was actually quite nice, but yeah, they're a bit paranoid about our lack of documentation, and the fact that we didn't register when we arrived. So they have now put us in the store cupboard of the medical centre attached to the police station. So you can kind of see, and sadly it's pretty threadbare. You can see there's not really much on the much in the store cupboard. But anyway, now we're having to sleep in here. Apparently we're going to sort out all the documentation issues in the morning, and there are 3 policemen just outside keeping an eye on us to make sure we don't try and escape. So yeah, definitely not how we expected the night to end, but maybe we'll be able to sort this out tomorrow. Hope it doesn't cause too much of a delay when it comes to starting walking.
Things didn't work out quite as simply as I imagined when we were in that store cupboard. Unfortunately, all our filming gear was confiscated from the 30th of June, when we were first arrested, until the 3rd of July, when we were finally released. Here's an artist's impression of what happened. Why were we arrested?
We arrested you because you are camping in a restricted strategic site. The dam is off limit to foreigners.
We were 6 kilometres from the dam. I could show you our GPS. Also, we have permission to be here. Look at all our documentation from the ministries.
My boss says he wants to speak to you guys. We're sending you to Melange.
But that's 135 kilometres from here, in the wrong direction.
Get them out of here, and confiscate their luggage.
We've already explained this all to you 5 times. We have all the necessary documentation. We didn't do anything wrong. Please just let us continue our trip.
Sorry, buddy. You're not going anywhere. You'll be spending the night here, and we can sort this out in the morning.
So should we tell our embassy we've been detained?
Oh, no, no, no. You're not detained. You just can't have your passports back and aren't allowed to leave the city.
Well, can we at least have access to our luggage?
Nope. See you tomorrow. Hello, gentlemen. I'm the boss around here, and let me tell you right now, your expedition is over. I never gave my permission for you to kayak along the Kwanza in my province.
But we have all the necessary permits. Just look at the documentation.
Nope. Looks like I have the wrong permits. Oh, and wrong visas. Yes, this really won't do at all.
But the Angolan embassy in London that issued my visa said it was fine. I even spoke to their representative from the Ministry of Tourism.
Nope. Don't talk back, you two. Get them out of here and back to Luanda.
But that's 400 kilometres away. Will you give back our passports once we go back to Luanda?
Oh, Of course. Just go back to Luanda and all your problems will be solved.
No need to panic, guys. You know how you were told to give your passports back here today?
Yes.
Well, we just need to give you a drive to Viana to speak to my boss, and then you'll definitely get them back.
We don't want to drive to Viana. That's 20 kilometers away. Also, the only thing out there is the illegal immigrant detention center. Why would you want us there?
Just get in the van, or we'll handcuff you. Right, guys, we're going to be detaining you here until Monday, when the Ministry of Interior can deal with you.
But why? We have valid visas and we haven't committed any crime.
Sorry, buddy. It's out of my hands.
Listen, guys, things are not looking good. But we at the British Embassy will do everything we can to help. The Italian Embassy are also getting involved. Okay, guys, we pulled a lot of strings, called in a lot of favours, and you're now free to go. Just promise us you won't get into any more trouble, okay?
Okay, thanks.
So, 6 a.m, Sunday. Yesterday, we spent the whole day in the Viana Illegal Immigrant Detention Center. Apparently, we've been cleared of all charges or whatever the issue was. So the plan today is to head out to Dondo and finish the kayak. So we've got 200 kilometers to go, which is about 4 days worth of work. So we're hoping if we start today, we'll be done on Wednesday. Roll into Kwanza Lodge and then that's it. We will have kayaked every single section that it's possible to kayak of the Kwanza River. That's the aim anyway. So we're quite enthusiastic to get it done, despite all these massive delays, all the hassle the Angolan authorities have given us. We're pretty sure we're good to go. I mean, I'm not entirely clear what happened yesterday, but it seems like they let us off and there's now no issues. We're left to see though. We're gonna be as careful as possible about not coming across the police or the authorities when we're going there. I think there's one checkpoint on the river which we're gonna try and avoid. Yeah, we'll just have to see. So I guess I'll check in when we get to Dondo. And I can't wait to get started again after almost a week of sitting around in police stations and immigration centres. What are you doing, Alfie?
Trying to find a quiet spot where we can slip into the Kwanza near Dondo. Yeah. Avoid any unnecessary police attention.
Yeah, I think that's definitely a good move at this stage. Despite having all the necessary permits and permissions and having been cleared of all wrongdoing, I still feel like it's in our benefit to not have to explain ourselves to anyone else or be dragged into any other police stations, immigration detention centres or whatever else they might have up their sleeves. Right, welcome to Kayak the Kwanza Mark 2. So it's Monday morning, it's about 5:45 a.m. Sun hasn't quite come up, so you can't really see much. We're being extravagant, we got two fires. It's just the way I like it. Yeah, so we got 25K under our belt last night. We're hoping to get 60 or 70 today. Aim is to rush through this last section and be finished by Wednesday. So we got today, tomorrow, and then Wednesday morning to finish. Alfie's down there busy on the boat because even after 25K, we had a lot of water on board, which means it's leaking. So obviously got another little hole or scrape that we haven't quite picked up on from when we went over all the rapids, which isn't great. But anyway, we're making extra special effort to avoid security forces, camp in the middle of nowhere, and whenever anyone asks, we're now telling them that we're just out fishing, or we're telling them that we're out for an hour or two, then we're going back up the river. So
We're no longer telling anyone what it is that we're doing, and we're hoping that word doesn't travel fast enough for anyone to do anything about this until we arrive. Not that we're doing anything wrong, of course, having been let off all charges by the immigration authorities and the police. So, Dr. Alfie, what's the prognosis?
A lot of holes.
A lot of holes, right, okay.
We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 holes at the moment.
Any more that you...
going.
Wow. And how are you fixing them, Alfie?
I'm using a handy glue called Patex, which I bought in a random market in Soma, Kwanza, without much hope, but it seems to be holding firm.
Thank you, Patex. Cola super forte!
And I'm sticking bits of inner tubing onto the boat because all of our repair kit got washed overboard in our crash.
And I've got to say, whoever it was on the Black Flag Cafe who suggested that all our problems could be solved with 550 paracord and duct tape, you are a genius, because look, we are solving all of our problems with a massive roll of Gorilla duct tape. So,
very solid stuff.
So what do you reckon? Can she make the last 165 kilometres?
I think just. I think she's just got it in her.
So you can paddle in our bail while we go.
Yeah.
Right. Right, today's Monday morning. We are aiming to get there on Wednesday afternoon. Let's just hope she holds up. Look at all these patches. Hello everyone. So we thought we'd check in quickly. Over there is Bon Jesus. And just round that corner is the final checkpoint that we need to go through. In fact, it's the only checkpoint on the river that has a boat. So we're kind of hoping that we get to breeze through it with no issues, and that the chief of police in Melange, Mr. Tony Bernardo, has not phoned ahead and told them to look out for two guys in a kayak. What do you reckon, Alfie? What are our chances of getting through problem-free?
I'm feeling optimistic.
Optimistic, that's what I like to hear. Okay.
I'm hoping if we get stopped, they don't open this video.
Yeah, we're also hoping that by making this video, we haven't jinxed it by being arrogant about getting through. So anyway, we will check in once we're on the other side of the checkpoint, and hopefully, we're just going to breeze through, and then we just got a final, what, 60 kilometers to go?
Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah, okay, right. Maybe. See you in a few minutes.
After Bom Jesus, we were only about 60 kilometers from the finish line at Kwanza Lodge. The going was tough as there was progressively more headwind and the kayak was on its last legs, but we pushed on.
So we're having marshmallows by the campfire on our final night of camping for Kayak the Kwanza. We are in Kasama National Park, having done 68 kilometres on the river, and tomorrow we've got about, what, 35, 40 to go?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then we're done. Finished. Assuming we have no problems with the authorities tomorrow, which I doubt, seeing as we're not going to bump into any. So this is it. So yeah, I guess if you're wondering, we did make it through the checkpoint, okay. The police didn't hassle us. In fact, I don't think they even saw us, so it was all fine. We made it to Kasama. There it is. So it's about 6 a.m. So now all we have to do is send some text from up here where we have signal, jump in the kayak, and then we've got about 40 kilometers to do until we get to the Kwanza Lodge, and we're finished. No police checkpoints, so should be there about lunchtime, unless there are any other issues. Like leaky kayak, but we'll see. So yeah, we've pretty much done it. I don't want to say it's in the bag yet, but yeah, in about 6 or 7 hours it should be. It's our final day, and look where we've arrived. That's the bridge, which means we are 4 kilometers from the Kwanza Lodge and the finish line.
At 1:30 p.m. on Wednesday the 6th of July 2016, we crossed the finish line, paddling out of the Kwanza River and into the Atlantic Ocean. We had officially kayaked every navigable section of the river, a total of 984 kilometres, during an independent, self-propelled journey of over 1,300 kilometres. As an added bonus, we found out that people had really taken an interest in our journey on social media. Turns out that sinking our kayak and getting arrested wasn't all bad. We raised over $25,000 for the Halo Trust, smashing our original target of $10,000. Alfie and I both agree that this expedition was one of the most challenging experiences of our lives. We lost 20 kilos of body weight between us over the course of the month. The poor Klepper is a complete write-off, and a lot of our possessions are probably still floating down the Kwanza. We might both have criminal records in Angola now, who knows? But despite all the problems, the overwhelming, generous support from everyone kept us on track and fighting to get to the finish line. We couldn't have finished the journey without the help of a wide network of people, from family and friends, to donors, and of course, the great team at the Halo Trust. Alfie and I would also like to extend our thanks to all the Angolan people who we met along the journey, whether it was lending a hand with mapping the route, selling us food, giving advice about hippos, offering shelter, or just stopping to say hello. We couldn't believe how friendly and welcoming people were. Thanks everyone. We hope you think it was worth it.